إن الحمد لله نحمده سبحانه ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله تعالى فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فأوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله، فقد أمرنا الله تعالى بذلك في كتابه الكريم، فقال تعالى: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. وقال تعالى: يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. ثم أما بعد. Dear brothers and sisters, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he once sat down and he explained to the Sahaba and to the entire Ummah, the last person to leave from hellfire, the last person to be released from Jahannam. The Prophet ﷺ said that this man would come, and as he escapes from hellfire and he's torched and burned from all that, and he walks away from it limping and falling, trying to escape, until he finally escapes, he turns back to hellfire and he says, Alhamdulillah alladhi anjani mink. He says, all praises to Allah, Alhamdulillah, who saved me from you, saved me from hellfire. And then he says, by Allah, no one, not a single human being that ever lived, has been blessed with more than what I have been blessed with, to escape from hellfire. And that was the greatest ni'mah that he could imagine that anybody could ever have gotten. And then at that moment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows a tree to grow nearby him. And when that man sees the tree, he raises his hands and he sees the shade in the tree and he says, Ya Allah, give me that tree. Let me drink from the water of the tree. Let me bask in its shade. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to him, I am afraid that if I give you the tree, you will ask for more. And definitely, the son of Adam is always asking for more. Always asking for more. He says, Ya Allah, give me the tree, la as'alu ghayraha. Give me that tree, and I promise that I'll never ask for anything more than that one tree. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows him the tree. And while he's in the shade, and thinking that no one else has gotten a blessing such as this beautiful tree being saved from hellfire, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands another tree to grow, one more beautiful than the first one. And when he's sitting and looking at his shade and looking at the tree, he sees a more lush tree. He says, Ya Rabbi, that one. Oh Allah, that tree, la as'alu ghayraha. I won't ask for anything more. And then he keeps doing this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, didn't you promise me that you wouldn't ask for more? And he said, Ya Rabbi, just this last one, la as'alu ghayraha. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows him that tree, birahmatihi subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands another tree to grow near the gates of Jannah, one more beautiful than the first two. And then he says, Ya Rabbi, that tree. Oh my Lord, give me that tree. La as'alu ghayraha. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, didn't you promise me that you wouldn't ask for any more trees? And he says, this is the last one. Give me that tree. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from His mercy, gives him that tree. And when he's basking in the shade and drinking from the water of that beautiful tree, he starts peeking into Jannah, and he starts looking into Jannah, and he starts forgetting about the tree that he's in, and he says, Rabbi adkhilniha, Rabbi adkhilniha. He says, Oh Allah, let me enter into Jannah. Oh Allah, let me enter into Jannah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya Abdi. He says, Oh my servant, Oh my slave, didn't you promise me that you wouldn't ask for anything more? And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said he couldn't control himself, but he saw the Jannah and he could only ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, what will finish me from your pleading? What will finish me from your consistent asking? would it suffice you, would it make you happy if not only did I enter you into Jannah, but I allowed you the riches of everything in the world, wa mithlaha ma'a, and continue and give you the riches of the world and the entire world as a prize over and 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 over 10 times again. And then the person, he stopped and he locked his eyes and he says to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَتَسْتَهْزِئُ بِي وَأَنْتَ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. He says, are you mocking me and you're the Lord of the universe, Rabbi? You're making fun of me? And then the Prophet, the narrator, he started smiling and he's laughing. And he said, ask me why I'm laughing. And they said, why are you laughing? He said, because the Prophet ﷺ was laughing. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, ask me why I'm laughing. We said, what makes you smile, Ya Rasulullah? He said, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala smiled when his slave said, أَتَسْتَهْزِئُ بِي وَأَنْتَ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. He says, do you mock me? And you are the Lord of the heavens and the earth. You're the Lord of the universe. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لا أستهزئ بك. I'm not mocking you. ولكني على ما أشاء قادر. But rather, I can do whatever I wish and I have the ability to do it. Dear brothers and sisters, if you turn to any page in the Quran, you'll always see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the Jannah and tells the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and is calling the believers towards this Jannah and warning them from the hellfire on every page. But I ask you about this Jannah. Has any of us ever tasted Jannah? Has any of us ever smelt the fragrance of Jannah? Has anyone ever heard the beautiful sounds of Jannah? The Prophet ﷺ said, and if you can imagine anything beautiful, the most beautiful thing in the world, know that Jannah is better than that. And the Hadith al-Qudsi, the Prophet ﷺ said that Allah said that I've prepared in Jannah for my servants, my pious servants, مَا لَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ, what eyes have never seen before. وَلَا أُذُنٌ سَمِعَتْ, and no ears have ever heard before. وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ, and no one has ever imagined it. Like they'll say, use your imagination, try to think the unbelievable. It has never come upon the heart of a human being what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is preparing for His servants in Jannah. And read in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَا تَعْلَمُ نَفْسٌ مَا أُخْفِيَ لَهُمْ مِنْ قُرَّةِ أَعْيُنٍ جَزَاءً بِمَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and no soul knows what's hidden for them from the comfort of the eye, meaning the satisfaction as a reward for they used to do. That they have no idea, مَا أُخْفِيَ لَهُمْ مِنْ قُرَّةِ أَعْيُنٍ, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is preparing for them in Jannah. In this dunya, and here in especially in North America, you'll see people that they're always trying to entertain people, and they're always trying to find the best way to have fun and have the most fun. But I tell you, dear brothers and sisters, that there are three types of fun. The first fun is what people think is fun, but actually behind that fun or those few moments of supposed happiness lies the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, lies regret in the hereafter, lies sadness, and it's not a true fun. Maybe on the outside, just for those few moments, the person may think he is having fun, but the ramifications, the things that come after that, it truly isn't fun, and that is the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When a person thinks they're having fun by drinking alcohol, or a person thinks they're having fun by committing zina, or a person thinks that they're having fun by maybe not wearing hijab or having fun with the money from riba and so on, they may think this is fun, but it's not fun in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when that person finds out on the day of judgment what happened to that, and in fact these things are called sayyi'ah, a sin, but sayyi'ah because it does evil back to the person, and it's not fun. The second type of fun that people think are the worldly things, the mubahat, the things, the permissible things of the dunya. Someone may be happy with a car, and may be happy with a new toy, and so on, the dunya. But this is cheap fun. This is cheap. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if they knew what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared for them. In Jannah, they would know the worthlessness of these material things, and suffice it that all these things will come to an end. And the third type is the kind that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared for His pious servants in Jannah. And this comes, the true fun is in ta'atul Rahman, is in obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The true satisfaction and happiness comes when a person memorizes a new surah. The true happiness and fun comes when someone is good to his parents, when someone does silatul rahim and tries to gather his family, make up between his family. That's the true fun, when a person obeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and a person can feel it when someone takes from his pocket, he only has a sandwich, he sees someone without a sandwich and he gives them, he knows and he can feel that fun from inside, can feel the happiness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِهِ فَبِذَٰلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِّمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ, by the virtue of Allah, وَبِرَحْمَتِهِ, and His mercy, the virtue and mercy of Allah, فَبِذَٰلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا, let them get their happiness and fun in that, هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِّمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ, that it's better than all the things that the people try gaining, all the money that people try collecting in their bank accounts. The rahmah and the virtue of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is khayrun mimma yajma'un, is better than that. And that happens with ta'atullah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You'll see some people traveling and they'll say places like Hawaii and Florida are a vacationer's paradise. And in these paradises that they claim to give the human beings, you'll see things like jacuzzis, and you'll see things like apartments and very big living quarters and cruise ships and so on. But I tell you, one thing that they cannot offer you is immortality. They cannot offer you to live forever. That's something they cannot give you. And if they have a huge buffet and there's a microscopic thing that goes in your stomach and makes you have diarrhea or a stomachache, can they bring you happiness after that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows you to become sick? They cannot bring you health and they cannot make you live forever. They claim this is a paradise, but in fact it is a naqis paradise, quote unquote, paradise. Because they cannot give these things, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives the fana, gives the complete, the eternity that a person has in Jannah. That's why you'll see them always talking about in their fiction novels about the fountain of youth, about someone looking and finding this special water that makes someone live forever. But it doesn't exist, and it actually is a fiction novel, because it doesn't exist in the dunya, it exists with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, either in Jannah for the person or in hellfire. Let's take a glimpse at some of these things, and only a few glimpses of the ayat that talk about Jannah in the Qur'an. The ambience, or the atmosphere of the Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And imagine yourself now, when you hear these ayats, imagine yourself that after all those days of waking up for Fajr, all those days when you turned away from the haram, that now is your moment to rejoice, now is your time to say, Alhamdulillah alladhi adhaba anna al-hazan. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, those people that enter Jannah, they say, Alhamdulillah, to Allah, praises to Allah, that made the sadness go away. Meaning the sadness of working hard, and not that sadness, but they strived in the dunya, fearing that they wouldn't be entering into Jannah, and that fear goes away when they enter into Jannah. Alhamdulillah alladhi adhaba anna al-hazan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Qur'an, وجوه يومئذ ناعمة لسعيها راضية في جنة عالية لا تسمع فيها لاغية. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وجوه يومئذ ناعمة, that faces on that day will be joyful and radiant, illuminated from the happiness of entering Jannah. لِسَعِيهَا رَاضِيَةً, happy that they did what they did, happy that they woke up for Qiyamul Layl, happy that they woke up for Fajr, happy that they threw that riba money in the garbage, happy that they wore their hijab. لِسَعِيهَا رَاضِيَةً, now they know that I'm lucky that I did what I did, and I'm happy that I turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لِسَعِيهَا رَاضِيَةً في جنة عالية. In the highest and in the lofty Jannah, لا تسمع فيها لاغية. The atmosphere. You'll see some of these beautiful places, like they'll say these Hawaiian paradise and stuff. All it takes is someone who talks too much to ruin your entire vacation. Someone who's backbiting, that's sitting right beside you on the cruise ship, and he's talking rubbish, and it'll ruin your entire vacation. But that's not like it in Jannah. With all this beauty, the people that are beside you will never speak laghiya. They will not speak in vain talk. They will not talk about brother so-and-so, what he's wearing, and how sister so-and-so didn't do this or didn't do that. There's no backbiting in Jannah. There's nothing of that. No ghil, no hatred, animosity, nothing of that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لا تسمع فيها لاغية. You will never hear this unsuitable speech in Jannah. And in fact, what they will be saying to each other is salam. Assalamu alaykum. Salam and peace between the people of Jannah. And Jannah, indeed, is the greatest gift that a person can. Mm-hmm.